I'm Professor Cathy Gormley-Heenan, a professor of politics from Ulster University, and today I'm at the Europa Hotel as part of the Commission's discussion on the economy and an all-island economy. Really looking forward to that, looking forward to hearing the discussion, the debate, the dialogue, and of course the dissent from some of the more common views expressed as well, that as a university that's what we do. We're here to encourage and stimulate that sort of debate, and I'm really pleased to have been asked to be in the independent chair at today's proceedings.
Today to the Europa Hotel for our discussion on Irish unity and the all-island economy. Your presence demonstrates the growing momentum in the conversation about the future of Ireland. In 2022, Uachtaráin Sinn Féin Mary Lou MacDonald launched our Commission on the Future of Ireland. It is an ambitious initiative aimed at broadening and deepening the conversation on constitutional change and Irish unity. To date, the Commission has hosted many successful conversations right across the island in an ongoing series of People's Assemblies. Sectoral events on the themes of rights, young people, women and rural communities have also taken place, and a Gaeltacht Assembly was held at Scaliga in Connemara. We want to encourage popular grassroots participation in the conversation about our shared future. We want everyone to have their say, and participation from the audience will be a key part of the discussion here today. So again, please, please don't be shy, and if any thoughts, opinions, feedback, anything at all that comes to mind throughout today's session, please do let us know, please do have your say, as we really, really would appreciate your input. Constitutional change is now fixed on the political horizon. Conversations about the constitutional future of the island of Ireland are happening across the country and indeed beyond. Irish unity needs to be planned for, and people naturally want to know what the new Ireland might look like. That means those of us who want Irish unity must provide the space for discussion, and we have to make the time to listen carefully to people's hopes, aspirations, and most importantly, listen to the concerns of those who have not yet made up their minds and may be unsure as to how they would vote in a unity referendum. Citizens want to know what the new Ireland will mean for them and for their families. A strong and fair economy is the basis for a thriving society, and it is for this reason the Sinn Féin's Commission on the Future of Ireland is hosting today's discussion entitled Irish Unity and the All-Island Economy. Irish Unity has the potential to unlock all of the tools which our island economy needs to function more effectively. A range of economic forecasts have predicted that the continued development of the all-island economy will lead to a stronger economy. Irish unity and the freedom to make fiscal decisions here on this island will underpin this. A stronger economy will in turn provide the basis for better health and education services, job creation, and an enhanced standard of living for all of our citizens. And on that note, I would now like to move on to our main discussion. I have the pleasure of introducing our independent chairperson, Cathy Gormley-Heenan. Cathy, who I'm sure many of you will know, has worked in higher education for 26 years and is currently the University Provost at Ulster University. She is also a professor of politics and has served on a wide range of public bodies, including the recent Fiscal Commission. We are delighted to have Cathy lead the conversation today, and I really, really hope that you all enjoy today's conversation. So, Gora Mila Mayogaf, over to Cathy.
Thank you, Orlea, and you're very welcome, everybody, today. As Orlea said, I'm here in my role as a professor of politics and independent chair of the discussion today. This is an interactive session today. It's a very active meeting. It won't be the panel talking at length. We're really keen to hear from you. will be asking for observations and comments as we go through, rather than a suite of questions from the stage and then questions from the floor right at the very end. So have your questions ready and be prepared for that. There'll be a note taken of all of the proceedings this afternoon, and that will be sent to everybody by email in case there's anything that you didn't quite pick up or anything that you want to follow up on again afterwards. And Tomás O'Neill, who's with me here, will help me with my chairperson duties, not least because I can lose the run of myself and we might be here till 4 o'clock this afternoon. So we do endeavour to be finished by one on the dot, but Tomás will help me with the timings, and also I have no glasses on. He may be able to spot hands up that I don't quite see. Tomás will also help with the translation of any contributions from the audience in Irish, and those contributions are very welcome as well. So we have in the audience today people from a wide variety of backgrounds, and you're all very welcome. We've got people from academia, we have people from business, and people from the community and voluntary sector organisations. And for all of you, I hope that you do get a chance to contribute this morning. But if you don't, or if you've got more to say, the Commission's accepting written contributions as well. I think there might be details on a little QR code on all of your seats, so you can either send that in writing or email commission@sinnfein.ie with your thoughts and your feedback. And without further ado, we'll get stuck straight in with a big question to begin with to the panel, who need no introduction, so I'll waste no more time on that other than to say we have Conor Murphy, MLA, Caoimhe Archibald, MLA, and Pearse Doherty, TD. And I'm going to start with a very big question, which is, can we afford Irish unity? Conor, I'm going to ask you for a two-minute answer to the very big question, and maybe some focus on the actual figures that have been bandied around.
Okay, well, the short answer is yes. Very quickly, the history of this, the island, the history of partition, when the Northern State was set up, it was the richest part of the island. It was actually, for the first number of years of its existence, a net contributor to the British Exchequer. And that changed, I think, once you got out of the 1920s. So it's been a net recipient. And the whole question generally around unity and affordability and the economics of it is always focused around this issue of the subvention, as it's known. That's the difference between what... And we pay taxes, by the way, we pay taxes to the British Exchequer, and we always have done. But the question is what the difference between what we pay and what comes back. Now, it's an accountancy exercise to calculate the subvention. The recent study, I'm not sure it was a study, but the recent paper produced by Fitzgerald and Monteith suggested that would be 20 billion. Again, if people, it depends on how you take the figures. So, I mean, they may have had what they considered to be valid arguments in relation to how they calculated that, but there were a lot of things they ignored. Some of the things that are included in that is our contribution to British national debt, our contribution to museums, our contribution to the royal family, all issues which would not be part of a reunified Ireland. They also made assumptions in terms of the immediate uplift in pay for public sector workers here, but not the immediate contribution in terms of taxes into an all-Ireland state. So other eminent economists like John Doyle in DCU have said that the subvention actually, when they calculate it out and strip out some of those issues, is as low as 2.8 billion per year, and that would be about 1.5% of the southern economy annually. So you can see the difference, and depends how you come with it. Really what we do need, and then we've had other people like Kurt Hubner in his study, which has said that the potential immediately in terms of reunification, specifically for the north, is a huge increase in economic output and prosperity because of the removal of all of the barriers on the island, all of the issues which prevents us, this two currencies, different taxation policies, different systems of government, duplication. When these things are stripped out, the potential for growth is enormous, not just across the island, but very specifically for the north, because as Caoimhe says, we're coming from a much lower base. Productivity has been poorer. Jobs, wages, all of those measures of prosperity have been much poorer in the north, and that is a long way from where we were 100 years ago, where the north was the economic engine of the whole island. So I think that experience has shown us that, as Caoimhe says, can we afford not to do unity? We continue to be attached to an economy that is either at no growth or low growth in Britain, and is not a prospect of getting any higher than that. It's increasingly insular looking. It's if you like, cutting itself off from the rest of the world economically and politically. And our prospects in terms of being part of a much more outward and more progressive country across the island that is linked in both to Europe and across the world, then I think offers it up enormous opportunity for continued growth. And increasingly, I'll finish on this, Cathy, increasingly the evidence is that businesses here recognise that they're ahead of the politics on this. And that isn't just businesses from a national or border communities. I've met with very many businesses from a very unions perspective who have their own view on the constitution, they have their own view on the politics of this place, but economically they recognise, and they already have established footprints in the south, they recognise that the prediction which George Quigley made all those years ago, who came from that background, that the best way forward for this island was an all-island economy. That's already happening. That has been growing very substantially year on year, and the economics and the business of it is much further ahead than the politics of it.
Thank you, Conor. Now, Pearse, some of those disagreements on the cost of the subvention would leave, I guess, for some members of the audience, this big question still of, is it affordable? So do you want to take some of Conor's points a little bit further?
Yeah, thanks, Cathy. Looking, you know, I know some of, and I've sat down with some of the people who've suggested that numbers as big as Conor mentioned, about 20 billion euro. And we can use statistics any way we want. If you read that paper, it says we have made certain amount of assumptions and we've ignored other things. And that's the key part. Because, like, when you look at the subvention, what is the subvention today? It's less than 10 billion pounds sterling. And we know that the state here has a subvention because of the reasons that Caoimhe and Conor has outlined, that the economic levers are in London, there is no decision making here in the north that benefits the economy, that it benefits society, benefits interests. But the question that we're asking is, in the context of a United Ireland or a New Ireland, what is the subvention? What is the subvention in day one? And that's a completely different question, because as Conor mentioned, you wouldn't be servicing British debt. Why would you? And that's what Professor John Doyle has stripped out. You would not be servicing the billion euro for the British Army in a New Ireland, so therefore that would be stripped out of the subvention. People here who paid into their pensions for years while they were working would still get their pensions paid, the same way that people in Donegal who work in Scotland still get their pension paid through the British Exchequer. So that would be stripped out. So that's why Professor John Doyle takes the figure down to as low as 1.5 billion, and then when you increase it for policy decisions, brings it up to the figure that Conor mentioned, about 2.8. So if you're looking at those type of numbers, it is absolutely affordable. Like, that's not in question. If you look at what's happening in the southern economy in the last number of years, obviously it's economy that's growing. It's growing at faster rates than all of Europe. We see deficits in Britain are running at about 87 billion, about 3% of income. Whereas in the south, it's actually got surpluses of about 3%. We've obviously been dealing with a huge issue in terms of migrants, and particularly those fleeing the war in Ukraine. The cost of us providing those services are actually more than what it would be to assume the deficit that has been identified by the likes of people within the ESRI and Professor John Doyle. So it's absolutely possible. The surpluses that we will record in the next 4 years in the south is 37 billion euro, and that's after us expanding expenditure by the region of 5 billion euro every year. The economy is very, very strong in the south. It is robust, and the reason it is because we've been able to take decisions that are in the interest of the Irish economy and the Irish people. I've been on the finance committee for 14 years. I've dealt with 14 finance bills. The finance bills are sometimes 200 and 300 pages long. What's announced on budget day would take about 4 or 5 pages to implement. The most important things that we do, or some of the most important things that we do every year, is we tweak schemes, whether it's the keep schemes or regional schemes or living over the shop schemes. These are all tax incentive schemes that are about supporting regions, supporting businesses, supporting sectors, whether it's the arts, whether it's sports. It's all, and none of those levers exist in the north. So obviously the it's not just about affording the north. Can we afford the subvention? The subvention exists because there is a dearth of financial levers to actually deal with the issues in the north. What will happen, as we've seen from the research and the modelling, that is that with a New Ireland, with those levers, there is no reason why Derry can't be as prosperous as Kerry. There is no reason why Belfast, which was the engine of the Irish economy, is not as prosperous as Dublin. And there is no reason why the North, which has got about a fifth, when we upscale it for population size, has a fifth of FDI to the rest of the state. When we see, and we meet with FDI companies all the time that are looking for other regional centres, there is no reason why, with the proper policies, that Derry, Belfast, and indeed places in between aren't their satellite units. So I have absolutely no concerns at all about the affordability issue.
Okay, thank you. I said I would move to questions from the floor very quickly, but I wanted to start with that big question, because often people get a single figure in their head and then focus on that, whether the figure in your head is a figure of 30 billion or a figure of 3 billion. Often you're stuck with one, and I think it's really important for us to begin with that debate, I suppose, on the complexity of the calculations and of the varying definitions of what's included and what's excluded. So I'm going to open to the floor. Straight away, we have a question here and a question over here. We'll take those two, and then Tomás will help me because his eyesight's better. Sir, if you could just introduce yourself at the beginning, that would be really helpful for everybody.
My name is Frank Martin from Tyrone, Carrickmore, where Pat Cullen is today, doing a bit of a walkabout and getting to know the people where she was born and reared. My whole thing, and I have great respect for the platform, absolutely follow them, know the debate, and I think most people that attend Sinn Féin meetings have heard this repeatedly, well explained. We listen to Pearse, facts, figures, and good. But the reality is, 8 years ago, when Brexit happened, every family that I knew were sick to the stomach because they knew what that meant. The 40 years of progress that we had, they knew in their hearts and their guts, without an economist, without anybody, what that was going to mean. And the bottom line is, we were right. The British went back to doing what they always done, and that's to starve us. To make life hell, to make life difficult. And they've now put us in a position in Sinn Féin where they're trying to get us to administer their austerity. So what I'm saying is, Brexit wrecked us. We need to fix it, and we need to make it simple. Tonight, today, the people that will speak to us have done it, and they do it as well as anybody could do it. I admire the platform. I admire the ability. I have no criticism, and I admire what Sinn Féin are doing and what they've done. But the ordinary people around me, the farmers, even the unionist farmers, they're losing. They're hurting, but they can't see it. And we need to spell it out. We need to get back away from the control of the British and get realigned. We have no future in Ireland until that happens. My granddaughter is a pharmacist, and in Ballygally, she can earn X, but in Athnacloy, into Monaghan or Cavan, she gets 50% more. How could Pat Cullen or anybody possibly run a health service? And that's the issue, and that's what's understood on the doorstep. That's what's understood by the ordinary people. Today is where people that are here, I'm sure, understand fully, but the vast majority of people say, when are they going to build casement? When are they going to do the ordinary things that we understand? Can Sinn Féin deliver? And the problem is, we can't. We have secretaries of state that are screwing us. Sorry, but that's where I feel. I think we need to come out with a clear slogan: we're going to fix it. We need to fix it. It's not about the accountants spelling it out for us. We know it in our guts. We know it in our heart. We know Ireland has a good future if we could get rid of the Brits. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. What I'll do is I'll take a few comments and questions and then open the floor to the panel to respond to them as a collective. But I think the point is well made. A lot of the conversations around Brexit and the implications of Brexit did not take place. And I think most of the pro-unity or pro-union commissions and organisations that have been established are of one view, that nothing should happen without debate, discussion, dialogue, dissent, allowing people the opportunity to think through the things in the way that may not have happened in a previous referendum. So we have Tom Hartley over at the corner there, and then any other hands up, we can direct the microphone.
and then one down behind.
Could I ask the panel to future a bit and tell us what is the impact on an Irish economy where you have an increase in the population of, what is it, 1.9 million? You have three airports, I think three harbours. You know, you've got a whole infrastructure that can slide into an existing Irish economy. So what is the impact? You know, people talk about the cost, but is there a positive impact on the fact that the island is bigger, better infrastructure, and you have a lot of facilities coming into an Irish economy?
Thank you, Tom. And then I'll just take one more guy about three rows from the back. Put your hand up again. Thank you. And then we'll move to the panel.
We've about 30,000 people leaving the south, like young people leaving the south for Australia. One of our biggest exports in the north is our graduates. We've thousands upon thousands of young people leaving the north to go to the mainland UK, to go to Britain, England, Scotland, Wales, to study at university because of the Mazin cap. And a lot of them aren't coming back because there's simply not the opportunities in the north. And at present, there doesn't seem to be FDI to change that. And alongside the fact that the corporate tax rate is far too high in the north, how do we build a United Ireland that actually delivers for young people and tries to make it so that we don't have to leave? Because every single one of my mates is talking about emigrating. And to be honest, if things don't change, I'm going to have to do the same because there's just not the opportunities here. So how do we actually bring in that FDI and deliver it for the north? And how do we make sure that we don't have such a massive brain drain?
Thank you so much. So we've got a question on Brexit, a question on the impact of the inclusion of Northern Ireland into an all-island economy and the positive impacts on that, and then the question of the export of our brightest and our best, our young people. So I'll start with you, Conor.
Okay, thank you. I'll try and take a stab at two of the questions. I don't disagree with Frank's sentiment in relation to Brexit, and I'm sure Pearse or Caoimhe can pick that up. Tom's point, we always frame this debate about the affordability as if we're a burden. So how can the North take this burden, or how can the South take this burden off the North? And it was interesting when this debate was going on in relation to the Fitzgerald and Monteith paper and then John Doyle's observations on it. David McWilliams then said 20 billion euros cheap at half the price. You know, it was a bargain. And it is down to some of the stuff that Tom has said. You know, three of the biggest ports on the eastern seaboard are in the north, three airports, two of the best universities in the island, which are networked into all of the other universities in the island, a network of colleges, almost 2 million people. Ireland being an island of 8 million people, it actually is a perfect size for an awful lot of economic and health development and research. It's actually the perfect size for advancement and all that, and already has a very good foundation for that. We have one of the best advanced manufacturing sectors on the island anywhere, leading in the world in relation to a lot of the things they do. A very strong fintech centre in Belfast, cybersecurity centre in Belfast, which is unrivaled. The creative arts things that we're investing in this city, both in terms of Titanic and now on the North Shore, are unrivaled anywhere in the world. The last time I visited, met a delegation from California from the studios there. They say there's nothing like this anywhere in the world. So we have an enormous, I think Tom's right, the debate is always framed as a negative when it should be framed as a positive. In relation to your point, there actually is enormous opportunity here. We kind of continuously repeat that. All our young people leave, nobody comes back. It's actually, we do want to increase the numbers that can go to university here. There is a percentage of people who leave who want to leave and will want to go out for their own experiences, and people want to travel the world when they hit a certain age, and that's great if they get all of the experiences that brings and bring it back here. But there are, it's the people who want to go to university here that can't is about 25%. And we need to find increased space for that. That involves more public funding, because either the choices are you either keep the Mazin cap where it is, or you add more places through public funding, or you ask students to contribute. And I think you actually then make university less accessible for a lot of people by increasing tuition fees into it. So there are enormous opportunities here. We meet businesses all of the time. Everybody is mad to recruit people. Everybody will take people in the morning with any qualifications and take them in and train them up and get them working. So there are enormous opportunities here. And I understand sometimes people can be frustrated with the politics, and it goes back to Frank's point, you get Brexit, you get a real sense that things aren't changing, but these are things that can become the catalyst for change. And so we do want young people to stay, we do want young people to feel they have a future here, but there are opportunities, we need to talk those up rather than kind of assuming that the economy's dead here. The economy is actually growing here. There are significant opportunities. There is a real challenge between the level of pay, and that's increasing the impact on public service. You can get much more money. My daughter teaches in Drogheda. She lives in South Armagh. Can get much more money down there in much better conditions. And that's a challenge, but that is a consequence of partition. And the only solution to all of that is to end partition and to create our own future and carve out our own future. And the sooner that happens, to Frank's point, then the better.
Yeah, thanks. I think in the context of the question in terms of young people, you know, when what we're talking about here is a new Ireland, I think it's a really good question, because right across the island of Ireland, you have young people, you have that feel that this is not the place for them, so, you know, going to Australia or elsewhere. And that's what the opportunity of constitutional change provides us. It provides us to actually look at what is broken on the island of Ireland, and there's a lot of things broken, but there's a lot of things good as well, and Conor touched in the progress in some of the exciting areas that we have in the north, and we have many of that in the south as well. But in terms of, there's huge challenges in the south. Housing is one of the biggest drivers for people leaving in the numbers that they are leaving. But that can be fixed. That's a man-made problem, and it can be fixed with the right type of policy. So the type of constitutional change, the type of New Ireland, that's part of the discussion in terms of the society that we're going to have that ensures that young people are able to stay in the place that they want to stay, to be able to have a job, get a place in education, not priced out of it in terms of housing, and to be able to, you know, raise a family if that's what they want to do in their own local community. So, and everything's fitcha fucha in all of that, and that's why it's all integrated. I think the issues, Frank's point in terms of Brexit is 100%, but it is really important that we try to make that point, because some people still don't realise and recognise that the impacts of Brexit that it's had on them, their businesses, their way of life, their rights, their entitlements and all the rest. So it is a really important point, but it's not just about this is what the Tories have done to us. The key thing is the European Commission has already decided, it's already there, it's already in a protocol that in the context of constitutional change, in the context of a border poll, the North automatically becomes part of the European Union again. Again, this is the opportunity for access to a market of over 500 million people, access to agricultural grants, access to research and development grants, access to a more outward-looking type of union with all of its flaws and all of that. So it is about explaining the opportunities as well. I think in relation to a bigger population and all that the North has to offer, like the key thing here is that we have, despite how buoyant the southern economy is and how the northern economy is growing, the reality is that partition is an impediment to both of them. That's the reality. The southern economy is also, Donegal is part of the southern economy. We have the highest levels of poverty rate in the state. We have the highest levels of unemployment in the state. We have the lowest disposable income in the state. We have the highest dependency in medical cards in the state. We have some of the worst health outcomes in the state. Why? We're part of the southern economy. Partition is the reason for it. Look at the statistics in Strabane. It's the same thing. So look at the border corridors. Partition is impacting on both of them. So what we're talking about here is breaking down a barrier, getting rid of the differences and all of the challenges that allow people, businesses, to grow in terms of currencies, in terms of two different restrictions and employment rights, in terms of employment laws, in terms of trading environment, all of those things breaking them down. But it's not just that, because that's just one part of it. It's about back-to-back. It's not even back-to-back. It's about joint-up investment. It's about developing, delivering investment on an all-island basis, looking at the island as an island, looking at the investment in education as an island, and how do we actually grow and build in the opportunities, making sure that we don't have a situation where the North has got 20% 80% less FDI than the rest of the state. That makes no sense. There is no reason why the North doesn't have the same amount of FDI as the rest of the rest of the island. And what does that do? It brings high wages, it brings productivity, it brings opportunities in terms of skills, it grows and enhances, it gets connected to a third level, and it has spillover effects in terms of other type of jobs and industries as well. So there's huge opportunities there in terms of scale, in terms of market size, in terms of breaking down the barriers. And even though the barriers exist today, and there are many, businesses and people are moving beyond them. 20% growth in North-South trade in 2022. North-South trade now has gone up to 9.5 billion. It's growing south to north as well. They're moving, as Conor said, they're moving beyond the barriers. If you dismantle the barriers, if you unleash the change, the chains, what we've seen in terms of the modelling that has been done is that the economy and in the north and the south grows. And why is that important? Because we talk about economy, we talk about business, we talk about deficits and all that. Economy, with an economy growing as well, it lifts people out of poverty. One of the biggest statistics to me, and the one that's most shocking, isn't what the deficit is or any of that, is the fact that a young girl born in the South today has a life expectancy of 1.5 years more than a young girl born in the North. And there's a reason for that, and the reason for that is partition. And the reason that it's all connected to health outcomes, to poverty, the fact that we don't have fiscal levers, the fact that London is deciding what is in the best interest of people in our communities. And that has to, that's the real change that we can bring about by constitutional change and having a new Ireland.
Thanks very much, Pearse. Caoimhe, I'd like to come back to you in a couple of minutes about the additional fiscal powers, because that might help address some of Frank's question around the consequences of Brexit and what additional fiscal powers might do for the northern economy. But I'd like to bring some more people in for comments and questions. So I've got two people in the same row along the third row down here. Two ladies. Yeah, there you go. Thank you. And then I'll come to this side of the room. I've got gentlemen in the third row here and one over in the corner here.
My second here. For the sake of the room, Roisin's question is really how do we go about showing an impact on the Gaeltacht areas, and how do we demonstrate to the people in the Gaeltacht communities the benefits this can bring them?
I'll take a few before we come back to that. So lady just along the row there, thank you. And then gentleman over here and gentleman over there.
Goramaigad. Just major leshin couple of gakesh, kesh to wine into simply. Amwal planail di anish, egan realtis sejesh cart, ogas and chunnel satush cart, major leshin forberge ekmekta, ata aveson matamaj ahintia. Agus ever a daw, kajena ruddy a vase of planshin, no kajena cogenat and flanshin, matashin di, or am I?
And then again for the room, so Russell's question there, with regards to both the Assembly and the Dáil, is if there's a need for planning now and economic development, I suppose the same, is there a need for it now? And the second part of the question, what would that economic development and planning entail? What would be, what would be involved there?
Super, thank you. Thank you, Rose. And then gentlemen in the third row here, and then at the back here. Yeah.
Hiya, Daniel. There was a bit of chat there around the FDI. It was mentioned quite a few times, and on the island we've been incredibly good at attracting FDI, and that's been because of the quality of our people in 26 counties, there's more people than ever has been employed by multinationals. Conor released his new sectoral strategy yesterday. We had huge success in six counties in attracting FDI for technology companies, but part of the challenge with that is quite often the cost centres, so it doesn't move the productivity dial. And secondly, our indigenous companies can struggle because of the wage inflation. Now, wage inflation is a global problem, but every time a new FDI comes, that puts increasing pressure on our indigenous companies. and how they can compete. So maybe there are two options, either they go offshore themselves or they sell out to an FDI, so within an all-island economy. How do we square that circle around protecting our indigenous companies and moving the productivity dial and not being a real focus on job creation, which is good for column inches, but it has a negative impact on our indigenous.
Thanks, Daniel. And then just the gentleman behind you there.
Gormail Mogad. Smisha Tomas from Ardmaca, Port and Dunain. I live in England. I travelled here this morning from Manchester. I've been living in England now for about 8 years. I'm very proud, of course, to be Irish. I've got a five-year-old little girl who was born in England, who speaks Irish and plays camogie, believe it or not. But working in England, living with working-class people, day-to-day, I can see that the majority, the vast majority of people in England know absolutely nothing about our struggles here in the north. They have a real appetite to learn about the history, the real history of the north. And somebody who has flown into Belfast today, I can see the lack of development in Belfast. I'll be in Dublin next weekend for the All-Ireland Hurling semi-final. And every time I go to Dublin, you can see the vast difference between Dublin and Belfast. My point is around tourism and, you know, how do we go about increasing tourism, not just in Belfast, but throughout the north? Because I believe that's a massive area of development. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. So questions around provision for the Irish language, questions around planning and what does planning actually look like, and that's a huge question, so we'll come back to that a few times. Questions around FDI and the pressures on our indigenous companies, and then the all-Ireland, all-island tourist economy. Pearse, I'll come to you first.
Well, Bidger talk about kitchen in the Gaelic or do spider because in the economy because a cantra gelterte because few went to we then cantra gelterte because and tower to the bunch lish and chang she lum good digging Bidger ni smoke hole arte na river a kafol ni higan gulyoraku and tower to the on bunch lish and chang or mar changa do his mar rudnyar na wallogat to be ill, mutter you five new fried Gaelic, mutter brandy, good for Gaelic, Fasklin Chamara, Giartella, Tadini, Gahedder Nation, the digit, the Quarter, Rudnyart, the Tatusa, Agazilate, which in Agazchin, which in smoke hole arty, a goosage Gaelic, Akmaradurtma, Gangafol, Ak Mankan major etany in the wool, Ruddy Jarifa, a Tarlu. Chinmage Ohio Udras Nagelter today, Augusto Udras Nagelter, the Lonnie and Snakanta, a Cantra into Twehe, Cantraha na will an ignomi art the ledger, and the will Jackrat the on the hill Kursi Umper Day, a Kursi Lehand Bond, a Gazelet Mission, Ahan Vienta should able to call art the Ure a value stag. It's coaching the call art the shot to Jenny Rudding Kosla vaccine for Honey Covid, a Gazelet Mission. So Shin Jarku Tokum said na Mate Enid Missionogut, Agriat Missionogut at na Hakwi Nyaku. Agus an foran acu le gírúiste ar cúrsaí ignámiart sa gaeltacht is féidir láfa obair mhóra dhéanú. Agus mo chuirmid údras na gaeltacht a gompraid le cos le fintar ar an situáisgur tuis a dhéanú chun maidh na bitir níos fearr gaheirín ar a déilin mid leis na deacrairt a tacu. Sin rud a bhí ógain go dtí seo agus bitir tairthe an le dhéanmhéin nuas na ní ró go leor a neistiacht a dhéanú in cóláirtí mar sin agus go fáil caithí siad níos mó agus níos mó cuairtí a bheith acu la codiúdófa. Ac sílam gól féidir ach dion. O'Hewan Gaeltarte, Tisha Inta Inta Tawarte, Gawol the Jobane or Fuel, Dante Sog, August the Division of Wolgahog, Lave Ableton, the Honey Sagaeltarte, some Sagalor, Dini McCanter Hain, Tisha them. In Galliv, the Kodjaku Malfarsha Mar, the one the Kinya Pasti and Shin. I guess the Pasti Gerha, Tessagan Yohiwe, I guess the aid mission, so there's an inter tower to go agriar to mission able to Honyat, or where in the area to Carlu, is Kinti and Gul Pastni, says the Cantra mission. Ohiwe, and Rave Upper Telegenu and Kishahar Rosa, Intim Gallis Gomlin, and Rave Upper Legenu and the Hanramsha, New Wenya Kursi Ignamirte, Acta Kursi Ignamirte, Fear Howard to Gadarla Shog is cut. The canchin the talking yellishin Lady and NTMA gets la bank canish Nahiran, Sean the canchin at the Majoret, Gahish of Vismuichu, or Kajeta Ariente Golave, Kosselish, I guess Jane Rave Opertalajenu. So just to mention in terms of the forward planning on the economy in North and South, it is absolutely crucial, not just that it happens from an economic perspective, but that the in our view, the Irish state in particular start that process where there is the avenues for an inclusive dialogue in relation to what constitutional change in a new Ireland looks like, including in the areas of the economy and discussions that I've had as spokesperson, opposition spokesperson on finance in the South. These are the engagements we've had with the central bank, with the NTMA, with people who buy Irish debt. We've talked about them, about the opportunities that will exist in relation to constitutional change, the increase in market size, the investment strategies and all of that. But there is absolutely a need to actually sit down and plan this out and to make sure that all of us who share the aspirations of a new Ireland, that we have an understanding of what the economic challenges, but more importantly, the economic opportunities that will present themselves, and how do we make sure that we grasp those opportunities and exploit them to the maximum potential.
Just very quickly to run through the 3 points. Pearse has outlined the benefits of planning for the All-Ireland economy, just to say what we're actually doing. Since we have taken the Department of Economy now just since February, for the first time in the history of this state, certainly the first time since the Good Friday Agreement, we have an opportunity to do it. So immediately we have increased our contribution to Intertrade Ireland, because the contribution from the northern side had fallen down for the last number of years below the level that we were obliged to input. We've also done the same for Tourism Ireland, so we're immediately bringing those bodies back up to a level from the northern side that they need to be. There hasn't been the level of engagement from government here or from agencies here that there should have been over the years, when referring back to 30 years since George Quigley talked about an all-island economy, and there hasn't been that level of engagement that there should have been. We're immediately bringing about change in relation to all of that. There is a very strong willingness from the government in the South to collaborate with us on that. We will be hosting joint trade missions in the autumn between the agencies. The economic agencies are now working very closely together, Invest NI, Intertrade Ireland, IDA and the Enterprise Ireland Agency in the South are now doing joint work together. We're doing a joint trade mission in the autumn. And so we're trying to roll out increasingly, despite that lack of engagement over the years, as Pearse has said and I have said, the growth in all Ireland trade, north to south, south to north, has grown 5 or 6 times over the last 10 years. So with assistance and with promotion then, the opportunities for that are enormous. In relation to the point made about FDI versus Indigenous, you're entirely correct. The criticism of Invest NI, there were many criticisms in the report that was done about last year, but one of the key criticisms was it lacked strategic focus. So when I came into the Department of Economy, we brought 4 points of focus to everything that the Department of Economy does, from energy to FE and HE through economy and tourism. And that was around good jobs, not just FDI for the sake of getting jobs, around regional balance so that the benefits of all of that are felt outside of Belfast, around productivity, because that has been, as I think there's a 40% difference between north and south, and of course net zero, which we have to adhere to the targets on, but actually creates enormous opportunities. So if we put that focus, we also said to Invest NI, Indigenous, it needs to get the same amount of focus as FDI, because the thing is, we have nearly full employment here. And if we attract more companies in, we actually just displace employees from one company to another. So we have to find a way to grow So part of our dual market access issue is not just about attracting investment in, it's actually assisting local companies to grow, to get into export. The first step for most of those people is north to south, and then get into that export market. So we need to see that focus in terms of business startup. We're a very small, medium enterprise economy. And so what we're saying is generally they have put their focus on these big companies that employ large numbers of people. We're now increasingly moving into space north to south as well in connection of clustering, so that we bring smaller businesses together and collectively they create that critical mass which drives the support and growth in relation to them. And just the last point in relation to tourism, I'm surprised you're only going down to Hurling. You should be going down tomorrow for Armagh playing. Similarly, in tourism, we have invested more money in Tourism Ireland. We brought our level up to the level it needs to be. The three tourism agencies in the island, and it was a deficiency in the Good Friday Agreement. We should have created one tourism body for the whole island, not just a single promotional body. So, but the three agencies and the two departments are now engaging. I did a tourism meeting with Catherine Martin on Monday morning in Armagh. We're now working as five together, two departments, three agencies. We're exploring and talking about how we expand the tourism brands, the Wild Atlantic Way, Ireland's Ancient East, the Hidden Heartlands, expand those into the north and create that more centralised tourism. The north has done very, very well in tourism since, ironically, since COVID, with a huge increase in southern visitors, because when people were captured on the island and couldn't leave, we got a big influx of people who had never been north before, and that has continued to increase. And that's great. So tourism is on the up, but it has a long way to go. And one of the issues is that the primary point of entry for international tourism is through Dublin Airport. About 70% of the tourists that come to the island come through Dublin Airport, and getting those people to come and explore the whole island is a challenge for us. Sorry.
Yeah, thanks. I think you have covered a lot of the points in terms of the questions that were asked, but I think it is just important to say that economic planning really does need to happen, and it needs to happen quickly. I think that there is huge opportunities for us, and often we talk about the cost of reunification. It actually should be looked at as an investment rather than a cost. And when we talk about the challenges that we face north-south in terms of productivity, it's not because people in the north are less entrepreneurial or innovative or any of those things. We have huge talent and potential here, and we need to maximise it and give people the opportunities to be able to reach their potential. Cathy, you had mentioned about wanting to ask me about fiscal devolution. I can pick up on that point now if you want to.
Yeah, I think the two economies, from what everyone has said, have very distinct differences, different currencies, different fiscal arrangements, different interest rates, VAT systems, all have impacts on the FDI question. But there is the possibility of fiscal devolution in some shape or form. And my question is really around what difference that might make to the all-island economy.
Yeah, and as people will know, we have very limited powers when it comes to the fiscal levers that we have. We get our block grant from the British government, and my job as finance minister, and Conor's previous to me, was essentially sharing out that funding, which has been reduced in real terms. And the only real fiscal lever that we have is the regional rate, and that then is a bill that's passed on to ordinary households and businesses, so it's limited in terms of what we can do with it. So as part of the financial package to restore the institutions, we had agreement that we would begin to explore a new fiscal framework, and we've made some progress with that already. But we also want to look at how we can have more budgetary management tools for us as an executive, and how we can also explore the devolution of fiscal powers. And the piece of work that Conor commissioned when he was finance minister, and that you yourself were involved in relation to the fiscal commission, identified a number of potential candidates for the devolution of powers. And obviously, as a party, we would want to have as many of those powers as we can, so that we have the opportunity to align what we're trying to achieve in policy objectives for our economy, for our society, for the environment, with the powers that we have, and to be able to use those. But in the first instance, it's getting those powers and then deciding what to do with them. And some of them are more complex than others in terms of being able to devolve them. So there was a number that were identified, things like income tax, excise duties, the apprenticeship levy, which we will, and many people in the room will be familiar with. It's a bit bugbear for businesses that pay into it but feel that it doesn't serve their needs. So there were a number of things that we would like to progress in the immediacy. As an executive, we will have to take a position on those, and we will have to get the agreement with other parties to try and pursue that negotiation with Treasury. But for me, it would be very much about devolving the powers and then using them to meet our policy objectives. And I do think it would give us the ability in the first instance to better deliver public services, and that's obviously what we want to achieve.
Thank you, Caoimhe. I'm hoping that we'll pick up some questions or comments from the floor from a business perspective. There's always the possibility in any period of economic or political instability that the markets get spooked. So it's kind of to the FDI point in some respect. So do we have any questions from any of our business people? I'll go to Colin first, and then Frank, if you don't mind, I'll wait 2 minutes and come back to you and bring in a few more. So fourth row.
Thank you. Colin Neal, Hospitality Ulster. And Conor, you sort of stole my thunder because you went off on it before I got to ask you. But look, I look at Tourism Ireland as a really great success. You know, it worked away there even when we didn't have an executive. And we've seen real benefits. I think is it €6 billion and 300,000 jobs in the island of Ireland in tourism now. And Tourism Northern Ireland have done reasonably well too. Saying it's 43% increase in visitors from the Southern Ireland, which is really positive because we're starting now to get that come through. So I suppose, look, you know, our members will have their own political views. We, you know, as an organisation, we don't have it. But as an organisation, we have a strong view that the Northern Ireland economy is really good, really positive. And a lot of our members live in the now. So it's really, you know, that can we actually grow the all-Ireland economy now? How do we get people behind that now? I suppose if I stray in the political world, that might reduce the deficit argument as we go there. But I'm keen to know, do you think we can? Because I think it's really where we do, because we don't just live off tourism, we live off the domestic economy. So if our domestic economy is doing well, you know, our businesses do well and our staff do well.
Thanks, Colin. So the question is really, can we have an all-island economy in advance of anything else constitutionally? Great, so we'll park that and we'll come back to that. Any other questions from any of our business reps? Frank, you're getting a second go here, but 2 minutes and 2 minutes only.
Just for my sins, we're deeply involved in wind energy as well and agriculture as a family. So what I'm speaking now is more with a business thing. One of the problems that we have is how to change away from overproduction on agriculture towards renewable energy. And the difficulty you have when you go for renewable energy, you have to have infrastructure. And currently you're competing with the royal estates. They're the people that are promoting, they're the people that are employing, they're the people that are deciding where the infrastructure goes. And I can assure you, it's not onto land that will be eventually owned and controlled by Irish people. The royal estates will control it. That's why it's going into the sea. And that's when, for years to come, long after we have our Ireland that we want, we'll be paying to the royal estates, the royal family. They're spending $50 million at the minute. That's their budget for promoting this type of business. So it isn't just a simple thing of uniting Ireland. They control our waters, as we know well from Loch Ness. So it's important that we have a policy and a plan. In the very same way, and I have personal experience of where £100,000 was offered for the promotion of a GAA book by the Royal Estates. And that was simply to the GAA, and they're promoting and pushing into the GAA in order to get gold mined out of the banks of the Greencastle or wherever it is. So it's important, I think, that we realise there's more just than what we see on the economy. There's a hell of a lot behind it of years and years of control and power. Thank you.
Thanks, Frank. And I think there's one more question down in the back row on that side. Is there someone in a pink shirt down there? Oh, this side, wrong side. Thank you.
What's the prospect of the 12.5% corporation tax before All-Ireland?
Good question, and also related to the FDI point, why would you come north if corporation tax is cheaper in the south? So we'll wrap all those up, and we'll start with Pearse this time.
There you go. So, first of all, I'll leave the 12.5% to Caoimhe. But look, that's all tied up in relation to fiscal powers, and it's not just about the devolution of fiscal powers, but it's actually the conditionality that comes with that. So do you actually get the benefit of the 12.5%? And Caoimhe will be able to touch in relation to that. But that's part of the offering in the South, and it's part of the attractiveness. Many of the FDI companies now in the South will not be paying 12.5% rate. They'll be paying an effective minimum effective tax rate of 15% as part of the OECD agreement, but yet still it'll be higher in the north. But it's only one part of it. The other parts are unfettered access into the European Union, not just in terms of trade, services as well. It's about an educated workforce that with an education system that is linked into the needs. It is about having the infrastructure and the capacity. It is about having the indigenous businesses that have been created around it that has supports the FDI sector as well. So it's making sure that all of that is there. And it's also about the stability and a recognition that in the South that there is an understanding across the political divide in the main of the importance of FDI, and that nobody is going to take, you know, nobody's going to do anything that will change that environment, that we recognise the importance of it from an employment point of view, the jobs that it provides in the region, but also the tax revenue that it provides that allows us to invest in areas like health and education and so on and so forth, and that every year designs are happening, changes are happening. Like last year's finance bill, major change happened to FDI, which increased research and development grants by another 5%. That can't happen in the north because the fiscal levers don't exist. And that happened for a particular reason, and because the IDA was talking to us and saying, this is what needs to happen to try and create more investment to retain the investment pipelines and so on and so forth. So can the All-Ireland economy happen before a United Ireland or a New Ireland is a very good question. The answer, in my view, is it can't in the way that I would like to see it. But there is no doubt that we can continue to break down barriers in relation to the All Ireland economy. There are some issues that are decisions in terms of states, in terms of currencies. Like we will have a single currency in a New Ireland, which is a major impediment in terms of two different economies and the challenge to an All-Ireland economy. We will have differences in terms of VAT rates, interest, tax rates, but if you have fiscal devolution and if you have the levers and the benefits that come from it, then some of those issues can be dealt with. We have issues in terms of employment. One of the things that I've been trying to get the department in the South to do, and Conor has been involved in this as well, is to change the rules that it would allow for employees that live in the South who work in the North to be able to remotely work more often. There's a limited amount of days that they can do it. This really impacts on businesses, and particularly the new working environment that we have post-COVID. We need to be able to adapt to that. So there are barriers that can be broken down, but ending partition is the only way that you're going to unleash the potential of the All-Ireland economy in its true sense and be able to exploit all of the opportunities that exist in relation to that. I'll leave Conor maybe to pick up on the wind energy issue, bar to say the fact that this is a huge frustration for us in our party in the South, where we do have all the levers. Other countries, when we talk to them, they're looking at us and saying, why have we not harnessed what is offshore in terms of our offshore wind energy, in terms of the potential there, and building the infrastructure, some of the infrastructure that we need to rely on is in Belfast, we haven't made the investment yet, but this is a huge opportunity for the island of Ireland, for the island, because we shouldn't be competing here, for the island of Ireland to actually have energy independence, but also to provide energy to other European countries in a which is a sustainable way. You mentioned, Cathy, just in terms of the spook in the markets, and I mentioned in one of my previous conversations, maybe said it in Irish, like one of the things when we're talking about the planning for constitutional change and what does an economy, an all-Ireland economy look like, because there's big questions to be answered. When does a currency change? How is it, what is it pegged to? At what date does it change? How does all of this happen? What happens to tax rates and how long do tax rates maybe differ on the island of Ireland during a transitionary period? And no one individual has a monopoly in saying that this is the answer to this, but these are the conversations we need to have. They're just some of the challenges. As I said, there's more opportunities than there are challenges. But we need to actually sit down and plan that out so that there is a clear understanding of what is on the other side of the referendum. What does it look like from an economy? From our engagement with people who purchase Irish debt, and also our engagement with the NTMA who sell Irish debt on behalf of the Irish state, the key thing here is to have a plan. Once you have a plan and say this is how we're actually dealing with the with a new Ireland in the transition period, then markets build into that all the time. What markets don't want, what business don't want, or what FDI don't want is they don't want shocks. They don't want to wake up in the morning and find that a country has collapsed or that country has taken on another state or a part of a state or so on. They want a plan. And that goes back to the crucial ask here that we need a citizens' assembly that is inclusive, that allows all parties to come together. We need a paper from the Irish government which begins the official discussion. And we need all of the interested parties to actually be feeding into that. This is part of the conversation that Sinn Féin has initiated, but we need this led now at a higher level, and that's something that we, in our party, if we're in a position to lead the next government, will ensure that happens without delay.
Pearse outlined all of the barriers that have been to an all-Ireland economy, you know, traditionally, historically, and continue to be, and there are some big barriers there. Yet despite that, the all-Ireland economy has grown and continues to grow at a very fast pace. And one of the changes you now have is you have policy on the northern side of the border, which is supportive of all-Ireland economic growth, all-Ireland economic linkages. So all of the agencies, and in fairness, there's been a lot of work going on in the background over the years between the agencies that are involved north and south, between government departments. A lot of work has been going on, even in the absence of an executive, that work has continued. So there are a lot of linkages organically have already built up between government departments, between government agencies, and obviously very organically with business as well. As I said, I would have met a lot of businesses over the last couple of years when we were preparing to go into the Department of Economy, many of whom I would have known would have been associated with traditional unionist support, outlook, position. Every one of them I met had a footprint in the South. Every one of them recognised that that was the way to go. I mean, agri-food is a very obvious one, but a lot of them, tourism, you know. So the policy now is actually moving to support what was already happening. That doesn't take away from the fact that we have significant barriers to overcome, and they will only become overcome in the event of constitutional change. But there's an awful lot we can do to support things that were already happening. And that's what we're turning the focus of the Department of Economy to now. And in that issue Frank touched on of renewable energy, we have a single electricity market on the island. We have a shared ambition, as Pearse has said, to become self-sustaining in renewable energy. So we're not relying on fossil fuels and all of the impact on business of price hikes, war in Ukraine, suddenly your electricity costs go 300% higher. Gas costs, cost of heating go higher for businesses and for domestic households, that we become self-sufficient in renewable energy and eventually a net exporter, because we have that interconnection on the island, we have interconnection with Britain, we have interconnection with Europe. That opportunity is there for us all, and we have a shared view. As a matter of fact, I think Monday week, myself, John O'Dowd and Eamon Ryan are meeting up at Foyle Port to talk about the opportunities for offshore and onshore wind and how this part of the world can service a lot of what is going to happen in the North Atlantic off the coast of Ireland and the Irish Sea. I get Frank's point about Crown Estates, and that is a focus that needs to be happening, because that's a barrier and it's a long thing. But we have plans for onshore wind which don't involve them. We have plans for biomethane, which can, and that thorny issue of land usage, because our land usage is primarily around livestock. So how do we change that into? We have this not be something understood by a Belfast audience, but we have too much slurry, and how we put that to proper use, how we make that something which is a commodity for farming, to put it into biomethane. The first injection of biomethane took place last August, I think, the first one that the locally produced gas went into the gas networks. So we're actually operating with the gas networks, and that ambition is to get that up to 22% by 2030. So we will be doing that. We're also doing geothermal, which doesn't require Crown Estates. There's one experiment up in Stormont at the moment, in the Stormont Estate. There's another one out at Caffrey Agricultural College, which the ambition on the Stormont experiment is to heat the whole of Stormont Estate office blocks through geothermal. So and that then opens up. I spoke at a conference in UU last week, I think it was the week before, where it was a gathering of government people, business people, manufacturers, and academics. So that's who we're bringing together. The fact that this is a small place is really good in terms of connectivity, and bringing them all together to discuss the opportunities. So big challenges for renewable energy and getting to net zero, but big, big opportunities right across the island, not just for those in that manufacturing side, but for those who will be, all of us who will be beneficiaries with stable energy prices, hopefully reduced energy prices for households and businesses across the island, clean, green energy, and the opportunity to become a net energy exporter to other countries in the world, and that those opportunities are. So that is all happening now. The barriers still exist in terms of all of those taxation, all those issues, but the opportunities that we can achieve, even in those limitations, are enormous. The opportunities beyond that then become much more substantial.
Caoimhe, you might want to also pick up the question of risk versus reward when it comes to fiscal devolution.
Yep, thanks, Cathy. And I suppose just to add to some of what Conor and Pearse have said as well in relation to Colin's question, because I do think we're headed in the right direction in terms of that north-south cooperation and the all-island economy. But there are barriers that remain there. And similarly to the comments that Pearse has made in relation to not being able to fully maximise that potential in the absence of constitutional change, similarly with fiscal devolution, it's not a substitute for proper investment in public services either, because you couldn't just heap more taxation on people to make up for what isn't there. You certainly have the opportunity to generate revenue in a more fair and equitable way than perhaps some of the ability that we would have to do things now, which would be just adding regressive charges onto what people already pay, and that, in my opinion, isn't the right direction of travel. In relation to the specific point around corporation tax, ideally we would like to harmonise the tax rates north and south, and legislation has been passed to devolve corporation tax. It has never been commenced because there's an affordability element to it, and what would be required to come off the block grant to allow for us to have corporation tax devolved would, in my opinion, be quite prohibitive. I think that the last figures we have, and they're a few years out of date, is 800 million of corporation tax receipts, and when you look at the pressures that are on our public services, that number will have also increased because there's been divergence in the tax rate since then. And ideally what you want to be doing is ensuring that ordinary citizens are benefiting through the creation of sustainable, well-paying jobs, and that you're increasing tax revenue and like furthering economic development. So I think there is more work to do in relation to corporation tax specifically, and it was one that was also covered by the Fiscal Commission, which said it is worth exploring more, but there are issues with it. And I do think that point around risk versus reward in relation to the devolution of fiscal powers is really important, because once you take them on, you can lose revenue as well as gain revenue, and that was the experience of Scotland in relation to income tax. We have long-haul APD devolved here, and we don't get the benefit of it, and yet we pay the cost of it every year. So I think it's really important, and it goes back to that point that I made before about aligning what we're trying to achieve from a policy objective with the powers that we seek to devolve and seek to use. And Conor has set out his economic vision that is around creating good jobs, is around improving productivity. If you had income tax devolved, you doing those things would raise your income tax without even having to touch the rate of it. Just having the tax assigned to us would benefit us by having an improved and more productive economy. And other interventions like childcare could add to those things as well, getting more people into employment. So it's about getting the powers and then using them in a way that achieves what we want to achieve.
Thanks, Caoimhe. Conor, before we go back to the floor again, there are those who would argue that Northern Ireland now has the best of both worlds with the unfettered access to GB and EU markets. So given that there is that argument, what's the benefit then of the all-island economy, since Northern Ireland appears to have benefits of its own?
Well, I think that's a bit of an oversold concept. The fact is that Brexit was bad for us, and that's the reason that people across political divides here voted to remain in Europe. I think most people in the north here recognised, from whatever political perspective they were, that Brexit was a bad idea for the island. I mean, the single market, the customs union, very clearly was already benefiting the island. The reduction of the border, the removal of the physical impediments of the border was very clearly beneficial, and people got that. The membership of the European Union was beneficial, particularly for our agriculture side, and people got that. So the idea that we have the best of both worlds, what we have is not as bad a Brexit as it could have been. So we do have dual market access, which is a unique benefit to here, and it's one that we need to exploit. And Invest NI, under my instruction, have been off developing what they call the value proposition for that, so that we clearly understand what does it mean, which companies, which sectors would benefit the most from dual access, how can we then support them to get into that, as this is about our indigenous businesses, how can we support people to go, also then to take that on the road and say, if you want to invest here, what is dual, because everybody knows we have dual access, but if you get under the lid of it, what does it actually mean? What does it mean for various businesses and sectors? So we have responsibility to go out and explain that to our own businesses so they can get into that, and for businesses who want to consider investing here. But the highest growth we had in our economy over the last period was in the service sector. Services aren't covered by the protocol. So, you know, this will work for goods, for manufacturing and all of that. And that is good, and that will bring us some benefit. But this is undoing the worst elements of Brexit. It is not that Brexit has brought us an enormous benefit, and Brexit will continue to inflict pain. As we're dealing in the tourism question, the British government are intent on bringing in an electronic travel authorization, which means that people, 70% of the tourists who come to the north come through Dublin, international tourists. If they have to now start filling in a permit, the percentage of that is going to drop. We can't access employer, and as Pearse had mentioned, the issue that we're working on of employees that come into the north and work, who are resident in the south, there are barriers in relation to all of that. So there are real negative impacts. The dual market access is unique to us. We have to extract the maximum benefit from it, and that will be very useful for some firms, but the overall picture is still a negative Brexit one, and it's back to Frank's point, the sooner we get back, and as Pearse has said, the European Union will already recognise that if our north votes to go in with the United Ireland, that we don't become a new country, as many others would be, to try and access the European Union. In most cases where there's constitutional change, the European Union looks at that as a new country that you then have to apply for accession. That becomes subject to the veto of all other European member states. We already have a unique access point that if we change the constitution of the island, we're automatically back into the European Union. So the dual market access is useful. It's a very useful thing, and we need to promote it and benefit from it, but it doesn't undo the damage that ultimately Brexit will do, and the only way that we will undo that is through constitutional change and automatic re-entry into Europe.
Thanks, Conor. I'm going to park the answers to the questions on preparedness and preparation, because I actually think that the devil's in the detail with a lot of this, and we speak at a very abstract level about there is a need to prepare, but what that preparation looks like and the sequence and off all of that, I think is really important. But I'll take I'll take a whole suite of questions now, and this may be your last chance because it's 25-1, so we may take a while. So I'll start on this side of the room first. I'll go to Colin, then fourth row, then there's five questions in a row there. Just work your way back, and then I'll come to this side.
Thank you very much, Cathy. Just like to start by commending the Commission for its ongoing work as part of the conversation, and to acknowledge just the remarkable number of initiatives that are happening, focusing on precisely the question that you've asked, the detail of where this goes next. I suppose my question relates to what the economy is there to do for people, and the question around improving the lives of people on the island of Ireland. Because one of the really significant arguments in favour of this change is that people will be better off in multiple senses in a fairer society that emerges on the other end of that. So what I'd like to ask the panel is, are the questions around the opportunity that this opens up to build equality, fairness, and the well-being of future generations into how we think about the economy? In other words, the people on the island will decide this question, but there are many people engaged in the conversation as well to improve the lives of people on the island. So I'd just like to hear from the panel about those opportunities, what we can do in areas like equality budgeting and other initiatives to ensure that when we promise that people will be better off, that that actually happens in practice. So thank you all very much.
Thank you, Colin. We'll take a few more. So hands back up again there. Guy behind you. Sir, with the FDI question, we'll come back to you if we have time.
Hi, my name's Kieran. I was just wondering how an all-island economy would affect culture and art, and not like outside the main commercial art centres that we have in Northern Ireland, because there's a lot of smaller companies, theatre companies, that would rely on small grants and funding, and that can be very competitive. And the arts is always the first thing to be cut during any kind of budget change as well. And also then, do we pay TV licences to RTE or BBC, who would be the national broadcaster?
Thank you. Thanks, sir. Next row behind again.
Good afternoon, panel. Pat Walsh. I'd just like to ask, well, first and foremost, good news last night on the delivery of 260 new social affordable homes for West Belfast. But recently, the announcement of the budget, the money's been cut. Where is the housing development going to go forward, or will it be put in the back burner? Where's the money going to come from to deliver the social housing and affordable homes? It's a major issue, not only up north, but in the south. Also, in trying to deliver the social housing and affordable homes, developers, builders are having major problems with the statutory bodies, i.e. the NI Water, NI, the electric company, the planners. Where are we going forward with it?
Thank you, Pat. And I think there's maybe one more in the back row. Yeah, gentleman in the back row. We'll take these questions, then come over here.
Thank you. My name's Ray McCord. I'm from a unionist community. And a couple of points are for the panel too. What is the difference between a New Ireland, right, and Irish unity? First of all, you know, I class myself the minute as unionist on the Remain part of Britain, and I hope, because I say that, people regard me as a Brit, that I don't have to get out, you know. It needs to be a wee bit of education, you know, and relating to it and respecting each other. They also, I would like to see the panel do what we do at victims' events and make it completely cross-community. And I'm not being disrespectful to use in any way whatsoever. But for you, this one's there, and I'm thinking what the people within my own community be saying. A lot of people will be happy with me coming here. But it's my grandchildren's future I'm interested in. Right? And that's what I'll vote on, what's best for my grandchildren. I would like to see more of this happening, and would say to people, influential people within the Republican side and nationalist sides, that unionism isn't determined by a small clique of people on the Shankill Road. It's determined right across the country. We don't see a proper representation of unionist people in regards to debates like this. One of the things that the unionist people will be saying, the finance talk is out of my depth. You know, I've been used to dealing with victims, not finance. So for a lot of unionist people, the comments will be coming that they are trying to buzz off, are trying to buzz in the United Ireland. And again, it's not being disrespectful. I'm saying what we say within the unionist community. More needs to be explained. And the best way I see it on a personal level is bringing people together. If you're going to have a discussion about a new Ireland or an all-Ireland, all communities need to be involved in it. Okay.
Thank you very much, Raymond. I think that's a very fair point about the finance questions being above many people's head, mine included, and there has to be a way to distill the complexity of the data and the sorts of things that come into conversations about what economic disparity looks like and what an economic future might look like that has meaning for people. And certainly at a university level, that's part of what we try to do, to take the research and repackage it in a number of different ways, bring it out into the public domain and have that dialogue and debate on what those numbers actually mean to make it meaningful for people. So thank you for that. I'm going to take all of these first, then a last round over here. So we have Colin's question on the opportunity of the economy to build equality and wellness and fairness. Kieran's around the culture and arts. Pat's around social housing, north and south. And then Raymond's around that pro-union perspective and what's best for grandchildren in terms of that economic future. So I'll go to Caoimhe first.
Thank you, and I'm going to address Colin and Ray's questions together because I think they're interlinked, and thank you, Ray, for being here and for your contribution. And I do think reunification will result in a new Ireland. It will be a new constitution that we will be seeking to develop, and I think very much embedded in that has to be that well-being of future generations approach. There's really good examples there already from what Wales does in that space, and I think there is a real opportunity to ensure that economic fairness and social justice are the principles upon which we would build a new constitution and a new Ireland. I'm going to rattle through a couple of the others as well in relation to the culture and arts. I think there are huge opportunities for the arts and creatives in a new Ireland as well. We north and south punch well above our weight in relation to the arts, and I think in the south they are quite well supported, relatively speaking, to the north, and we could definitely do better in that space, and I think we should do better. So I think there is opportunities there. In relation to the social housing commitments, there are huge challenges in relation to our budgets for capital investment as well as our resource budgets, and we were really, really challenged with that this year, but the commitment to delivering on housing is absolute, and we're going to look at all options in terms of what we can do in relation to that, and as soon as there is a new government next week, we will be very strongly making the case that there does need to be that investment in infrastructure, housing in particular, but also that wider infrastructure in relation to wastewater, to roads, to investing in what we need to do in terms of renewable energy, because it's not there at the level that it needs to be at the minute, and it does need to be looked at differently.
Caoimhe, I did say to the audience at the outset that I would bring in as many voices as possible. I'm looking at my watch. I'm reminded by Tomás that time's ticking on. So before Conor and Pearse come in, I'm just going to grab the rest of these questions, and then you can take whichever of them we can mop up in the next 10 minutes. So if we have both mics over to this side of the room, we've got four. We have the second row, the third row, and the fifth row, and one right down at the back there in the corner, sir. So the guy in the blue here. Oh, we'll take the gentleman at the back first. Yeah, the microphone's back there. We'll work our way
sorry.
Up.
Damien McCain, and I'd just like to put my record thanks to Caoimhe, thanks to Conor, thanks to John O'Dowd, because coming from Derry in the northwest, it's the first time, I think, since the foundation of the state that we've seen some focus basically to Derry in the northwest. As I say, it's going to sound difficult or challenging Belfast, but Belfast has, you know, people are saying about flying into Belfast and the difference between Dublin, but you want to come to the northwest. So my point is there's been 80 to 90% of the funding or financial support goes into Belfast. Derry, you have you're bringing the expansion to McGee. You're bringing Invest NI over the Glen Sheen. My question to Caoimhe and to Conor is, what the challenges that are there at the moment, how can we get this funding ring-fenced? And how can we actually get milestones put in place? Because, as I say, Pearse has already touched it. Derry and Donegal and Tyrone is one geographical unit. Highest deprivation, highest lowest disposable income, highest unemployment. And my point would be, on a 5 to 10 year expectancy for a united Ireland, Derry in the northwest cannot wait. So we need to transition. So,
thank you, Damien. We'll start moving forward. There was a fourth row. Yeah, lady in the fourth row. Oh, yeah. Sorry, the fellow beside Colin. Thank you.
John Doherty, Regen. Whenever we see how finance is run historically in the north, you always get this sense that you're jumping from one crisis to another. To what extent do you feel that you're limited in your ability to, both Sinn Féin and the rest of the parties in the north, to create, to carry out a vision that's going to take you into the next generation?
Thanks very much. And then I think there's one just ahead. Yeah, in the orange and then in the blue.
My name is Kevin. Next Friday morning, we will have woken up, I suspect, to a Keir Starmer government in Britain. And despite the fact that profits of companies are enormous and have grown enormously in recent years, and despite the fact that there's a wealthy class that got even wealthier over the last 15 years, and despite the fact that wages for ordinary people have been stagnant for many years, Starmer has promised very little. He's promised to continue much the same policies that have been pursued by the Tory government. What I'm really asking is, what would a united Ireland be promising? What would our leaders of Sinn Féin be promising if that was to be achieved? And what fiscal policies would be used to ensure there was a narrowing of the gap between the very wealthy and the very poor?
Thank you, Kevin. And then just one question in front of you, the gentleman in the blue. And then we'll try to tick all of these together.
Good afternoon. My name is Kieran O'Neill. I'm involved more with the motorsport and the classic car scene. Some of these questions make me feel worried about this one, but I'm going to go with it anyway. First, I'd like to thank Deirdre Hargey, who's personally tried to bring the World Rally Championship to Northern Ireland, and it didn't happen. And tourism-wise, it's massive. It's one of them sports that's underground and a lot of people don't know about. We currently have a chance now in Ireland to bring it forward into Ireland, so hopefully Pearse, you'll get the finger out. And bang, it's a massive tourist draw. But my question is, and there's a lot of questions I get asked, what will happen to registrations of vehicles when we do go in all Ireland? Because Ireland don't have personal registrations. Or Northern Ireland, a lot of people have invested a lot of money in personal registrations. And they're thinking, what's going to happen? And that would be it. Thank you.
And that's what I mean about the very specific details. Thank you very much, Kieran. Okay, I'm going to pass over to the panel to take as many or in a various combination. You don't have to take them all. And then we have one final wrap-up question.
Okay. I'm going to leave the registration question to Pearse. I personally am looking forward to seeing Armagh on the AH on the number plates. I'm going to have that Armagh 02 on mine. It might be the only All-Ireland we ever win. I'll skip through just a couple of these, and there's some of them may lend themselves more to both Pearse and Caoimhe. Colin asked a question about the use of the economy. Of course, as Pearse said, politics is about the happiness of people. That's and developing the economy is about having a fair society which people can feel fulfilled and contribute to and earn sufficient to keep them in a good way of going on. There's always an assumption, and it comes back to Raymond's point, which I'll come to as well, that unification just means absorbing one thing into the other. There are things that are done in the north that are better in terms of society than are done in the south. So not all of the answers to all of the problems that we have are just absorb ourselves. So for instance, we do, even within the limitations we have, so myself and Caoimhe and Gordon Lyons, three ministers, are working together on community wealth building projects. We have two pilot schemes, one in Derry and one in Larne, who are working closely together, and that's not two towns that you would put closely together, but they're working there. So we have a lot more effort in that. When I was doing procurement, when I was in what's Caoimhe's now job, we were introducing social value contracts into government procurement. You cannot get a government contract now unless you're paying the real living wage to people. You have to have at least 10%, and that will move to 20% social value attached to government contracts. So in some ways, even in our limitations, there's been much more focus on how we use economic benefit to uplift everyone and not just leave it to the tendency in the southern establishment parties is the market. The market will look after things and things will equalise themselves out as they come, with enormous challenges in the southern state in terms of poverty, isolation, deprivation. I mean, we all collectively live in border counties. So we know the experience either side of the border of what that looks like to be on the periphery of both states. So Raymond's question, what's a new Ireland look as opposed to United Ireland? Because quite often the debate has just been about absorbing the six-county state into the existing structures. This is a genuine opportunity to create something new and something better, something which recognises the very significant British identity in Ireland and that engages with that in the preparation, as is vital, but engages with that in terms of the constitutional makeup of a new Ireland to give due respect and due a place for people who don't necessarily feel comfortable within a kind of Irish identity. So that's the difference between just having a united Ireland. It's just take the border away, take the Union flag off, whatever, and take the British government system out of here. And this is genuine an attempt, and this dialogue is genuine an attempt. And it does focus on the finance, because quite often with people who are opposed to that present that as the number one argument. But I know there's much more in terms of what unionists think and feel about who they are, what their place is, what their identity is, what they want the future. I expected this question to come to me first, because I'm the only person on the panel with a grandchild. But I know that question is much deeper than finances. And the sense that, you know, we can buy unionism in the United Ireland is a disrespect to people within the unionist tradition, because that's not their primary motivation for their own outlook. So this is much more broader engagement with what it means to be. Demographics are changing on this island. There is change happening. What we have to do is come at it in a way which makes that space for change as comfortable as everybody who wants to be part of the conversation and who will be. You know, we can't stop the tide of demographic change. We can't stop the sense and the notion for a growing number of people on the island and in the north in particular that the current constitutional framework is detrimental to us. And it's going to continue to be detrimental to us economically and politically and socially and all of those ways. So there's an impetus on those who want, of those, or an onus on those of us who want to change that and want to do it as quickly as we can, to engage with all of those who don't feel the same way about that. And that includes people in the south as well, who don't feel the same way, and to try and work that through. The best way to do that is to a very formal structure which creates a space. This is a Sinn Féin created space, and it's as open and as democratic as it can be, and as inclusive as it can be. But an Irish government doing this would have a much greater effect in terms of that dialogue. I attended a conversation in the Fela a couple of years back on one of the events, and a kind of leading surgeon here who comes from a unionist background, he made the point of that which really resonated. He said, an Irish Taoiseach has never said publicly, and that might be corrected in recent years, we want unionism in the United, we want you to be part of our United Ireland. As an Irish government has never reached out in that way to say, we're preparing for United Ireland, but we want you to be part of it, we want you to be part of that discussion. I think that's a more powerful voice than just a political party doing this, although we obviously have a strong voice in relation to all of that, and we're organised on our base, and we want this to be an inclusive conversation, and I think that is very important. I don't want a new Ireland that excludes people. I mean, I was in a part of Ireland that excluded people. It doesn't work. I don't want a new Ireland that treats people from a unionist and a British perspective in the same way we were treated in the Northern State, my parents, my grandparents were treated. That, to me, that's not something that I would aspire to at all. It's not something that I would want to work to. It's not something that I want to be part of. We want a genuinely new Ireland as opposed to just absorbing Ireland into the Northern State, into the Southern State. On the question about regional balance, yes, we are putting that focus there. McGee is the catalyst for economic growth in the Northwest, but as Pearse has said, the problems of the Northwest aren't confined to the Derry side of the border, and we have agreed programs with southern ministers and agencies to try and put a real focus on the Northwest. We have a responsibility when we have at least some control over these levers to try and affect change and to try and do that away. So it's not about waiting for New Ireland, United Ireland. These things need to happen now, and that's why we're putting that strong focus there. And I hope it's already started to yield benefits in terms of confidence, which is generally the first thing you need for economic growth, and that is followed through there in terms of real differences happening. We're already expanding the numbers in McGee. That will go up again in this year's intake. And we've put the task force together because it's not just about University of Ulster, or Ulster Universities are now called, to offer more courses and attract more students. There's a whole infrastructure in the city needs to develop to support that economic development, and that is working very closely. The first question we put, and we're waiting a response that I think is positive, is the bus services. What are the bus services going to be for students coming in there? And TransLink are coming back to us, I think, in the next week or two to tell us how they intend to cope with an increased intake. So it's a whole system approach. The road, the Belfast Derry Road, the S6 is there now. We are going to invest in Derry Airport and continue to invest in Derry Airport. Economy have now taken from infrastructure, because there's always a divide as to who was responsible for that kind of infrastructure there, that very core part of economic development and connectivity. We're now taking the lion's share of responsibility for that, and we will look after the airport in the time ahead and stop this ping pong between government departments as to who's responsible. So the Derry needs and the Northwest need our answers, they need action, and they need commitment, and that's what we intend to provide in the time ahead. I'll allow all the harder questions on taxation and car licences and registration plates to go to Caoimhe and give it to Pearse.
Pearse, I'm going to ask you on behalf of Conor and Caoimhe as well to wrap up on the preparedness question and what that looks like in practical terms, if you can finish on that.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you. Look, I just on the point, and Conor really touched about it, but about, we've talked a lot about the economy because there's a theme about this year in finances, but like, the economy has to serve society. Like, it can't be the other way around. So when we talk about unleashing the potential of the All-Ireland economy, why are we talking about that? Because we want people to be able to have decent jobs, we want to be able to feel valued in their place of work, we want to be able to have tax revenues that can support the type of services that we want, whether that's investment in the arts, whether it's education, whether it's in health, infrastructure, all of those areas. And like, that's one of the big challenges in the South, where we have a very buoyant economy. We have, you know, the envy of Europe in terms of surpluses and growth and FDI, and we've got many of the tech companies, the leading lights in the world are headquartered, European headquartered in Dublin or in Cork. We have pharmaceutical companies, some of the leading in the world there, but yet we still have people with children with scoliosis who can't get treatment. We have people with disability who can't get access to the service they need. We have people who still can't find employment. We have children, 4,000 children who live in hotels because they can't have, there's no affordable housing for them. So the economy has to be about society. So when we talk about what is a new Ireland, to talk to Ray's point there, why not a united Ireland and new Ireland? Because I don't want to live in just a united Ireland where that child still doesn't get the operation, that a constituent of mine who's got a curvature of 90% in their back is looking at a clock that's ticking, because if it goes any further, it's inoperable. That's not the type of Ireland that I want to be part of. Obviously, it'd be better, United Ireland would be better than what we have, but this is a real opportunity for us to reimagine what is the best on the island of Ireland and leave what is the worst or some of the things that we don't like behind us. It is a unique opportunity that nations don't have in the world, where there is an agreement in terms of, through the Good Friday Agreement, to agreed constitutional change through a democratic process. And it's an opportunity we have to grip. And there is a likelihood, if we don't grip that opportunity, that Conservative forces who are happy with the status quo would just allow a referendum to mean that it's a north stitched into the south, which isn't the type of Ireland that I believe in. I think the arts and culture is a huge part of that, and we had a good focus on that in some of the sessions that the Commission did in before. And I think that has to be a very clear and loud voice in relation to this. I don't think it should be in any way that it's competing in terms of funding. I think we need to, the arts and culture have to be a part of what that New Ireland is. I think that's the positive. I think that's the benefit. And I think we need to be looking at how do we actually support that. And you mentioned about the TV license. Well, a lot of these decisions depend on, well, who then is in government in a New Ireland and all those type of questions. And let me say, Sinn Féin want to abolish the TV license. So in a New Ireland, there will be no requirement to fund RTE. So just to bear that in mind, if we are in government in that scenario. Just a couple of points in terms of the Northwest, and Conor talked about that. I think there's huge potential there, but there's also huge work being done on, you know, Conor outlined the work that's been done by the Department of the Economy and the focus that Sinn Féin have taken to that Northwest region. In fairness, there has been reciprocal work by successive governments now putting this issue on the agenda as well, and much of that we've argued down throughout the years, going right back to St Andrews when we got it over the line that both the Irish and British government would co-fund the A5, which we hope will start to see the green light before the end of the year, but also making sure that the North West actually was able to benefit from that. And there's much to do there. We need a city deal. We talk about the city region. The city region's Derry, Letterkenny. Letterkenny doesn't have a city deal at the minute. The All Island Rail Review is only a review. We need to now look at what can we do and how do we tie up infrastructure. A number of myself and my colleagues went to the European Commission over 20 years ago. We put a map of Ireland before the Transport Commissioner at the time, and we showed the motorway network and we showed the rail network, and he genuinely asked, was this a desert, which was the whole Northwest region? And it doesn't make sense. You know, if we're reimagining the island of Ireland, why would you have the fourth largest city on the island of Ireland, which is Derry, not directly connected to Dublin, either through motorway or rail? And these are basic things that enhance the quality of life of people in terms of being able to access, and but also open up huge opportunities. In terms of the motorsport issue, this is something, in terms of the World Rally in 2025, it's something that we've already raised. Fingers are firmly out. We've already raised this with government. We're very, very annoyed that the department actually allowed this to slip. The department said that they wouldn't be able to process they would need 6 months, and therefore the World Motorsport has said that it's not on the table for 2025. We're extremely critical, and we genuinely believe if that was a different type of sport, the finger from government would have been out. And I just think, you know, there's some type of sports like rally sport, boxing, that the government don't give it the due attention and all of the rest. But it is something we'll pick up again. I actually love the fact that you can look at a car and you know which region it comes from and all the rest. So personalised plates, it's not something I've had in the discussion of New Ireland before, but that's the importance of it, because everybody will come to this discussion with their own areas of interest, and these are some of the issues that we have to go through. There are unique number plates in the south where you can actually pay a premium to get a particular number plate, but it still has to fit within the guidelines of the year and the DL. But you might be able to get a 1916 one or a 19 such and such one. But yeah, it is. Like, these are some of the questions where we need to happen in terms of preparedness. Like, I genuinely think, and maybe it's more hope, but I do have a feeling that the political system in the South is moving more towards a realization that they need to plan, that they need to prepare. I think the election results in the North, and we'll see the election results now what's only a number of days now, a little over a week, have shown the changes, the demographic changes, but also the fact that Brexit has turbo-boosted the conversation, and that conversation hasn't been confined to just the North. So I think there is more and more awareness. I think the work that Ireland's Future has done has been absolutely instrumental to creating that awareness by ensuring that people from across the political divide have been able to be part of those engagements and hear the views of many, that there is a greater understanding of the need for the political establishment to plan. So I would not be surprised at all that obviously if Sinn Féin are in government, there will be, we will set up the forums that are required. But I think across the political divide, there is more and a greater understanding of the need to do that. I think that the inevitability of the referendum it has dawned on those in the South that it is going to happen, and they have looked across the water and looked at the Brexit scenario where a vote was carried without any planning, without any understanding of what happens afterwards. So what that preparedness looks like is we do need the forum, we need the All-Ireland, the Oireachtas committee that takes in all of the parties, North and South, to be able to engage. We need the civic forum or the that kind of constitutional assembly where civic society can engage in it, and it has to be as inclusive as possible, open to all. And we need the government then to produce a green paper that starts an official conversation at a state level. And then all of the other conversations, like every group that I meet with, I talked to them, whether it's a Chamber of Commerce in Carlow last week, it was like a United Ireland or a New Ireland is going to happen. A referendum is going to take place. In my view, it will be a positive result because I believe in the benefits of it. So what are your businesses, what is your organisation doing to look at it? The GAA, the arts sector, the, you know, every sector needs to be involved in this conversation now. But I think the starting, the firing gun will be when a government actually says we're going to prepare a green paper and we're going to officially start this conversation. And that's what really needs to happen without delay.
Thank you, Pearse. I'm going to bring the panel piece to a close now, and thank you all for the extent of the remarks. When they said that this was a session that would run from 11 to 1, I thought, well, that's a bit long, and we're already at 1:05 and probably could have taken another questions. But more importantly than thanking the panel, I want to thank the audience, because the range of questions that you've asked have actually sparked a whole lot of questions in my mind, questions that probably require a lot of research and a lot more depth of thinking. So thank you for that. You probably have a lot more questions in your mind as well. Certainly the personalised number plate is one that everybody will go away thinking about now. So you will get an email today from the Commission after the meeting, and I would encourage you all to respond, give your feedback and any questions that you think of, however abstract and high level or small and detailed, are probably really important, and there's no question that is inconsequential. So if you join me in thanking the panel, first of all. And then once again, on behalf of the panel, thanks to everybody here, and I hope we see you again soon for another debate, dialogue, discussion, and also dissent.